She's saying it's full. That's fine. All right, so if you could do me a huge favor, I'm very easily distracted. So if you could all check that your phone's either silent or turned off or whatever you'd like to do, because it will distract me and I will banter you. So welcome to the Dial Plans and Voice Management Deep Dive. Let's start with this. I'm Cornel Burns. We're going to talk about the voice routing in Link Server 2010. A numbering approach on how do you actually configure enterprise voice, what do you need to take into account. We're going to talk about some best practices, some things we've seen from the field. This is boring, but it's going to be a heavy session. We're going to go through a lot of concepts, and I'll go to try to shake it up a bit with a machine that I've got running, and whatever I'm talking about, I'll show you, so you can check that it's actually true what I've said. It is going to be a lot of slides, it's going to be a lot of information. I'm going to try to finish in 60 minutes, because we're getting ready for the party, right? And then you'll get 15 minutes to ask me any kind of question about voice usages and routes and whatever you'd like. We're going to talk about, in short, we're going to start with our routing. How does Link handle voice from a routing perspective? We're going to look at numbering and dialing. We've got stuff like dialing rules. What do they do? Why do we use them? Why do we need them? Some routing and authorization. And we'll look at our best practices and some things that might go wrong. Who am I? I'm Cornel Burns. I'm from the Netherlands. I'm a local. It's very nice to go to an event where you can actually drive by car. I've brought two colleagues. I've brought Mr. Binder and I've brought Mr. Duong. We sort of travel the world with the Voice Center of Excellence, and we tell people on how Link Voice works and works best within the organization. So whatever you'd like to ask me, just go ahead. We'll make sure we'll have some time for that. My background is in voice and networking. I used to do that for a big telephony company, Dimension Data. I moved to a local partner, a Wortel, and then I moved to Microsoft. So that's me in a nutshell. So the things we're going to talk about today, and not everyone has a telephony background, so our important terminology for today, whenever we're talking about outbound calls, link to the PSTN. PSTN is the public net, the PSTN, the public switch telephony network, basically your phone. PSTN call is to the outside, internal call within the company. A DID, or also known as the DDI, it's a direct number, so it's basically your telephone number, your mobile number, or your fixed line. We're going to be talking about reverse number lookup. And as with all Microsoft examples, we're going to be using the North American number plan. So plus one for the US. And let's take Kirkland, which is 425 for Washington as a region code. And it was 808. I don't know. I looked it up. Is it correct? 808? There we go. 808. So I have a German example as well. But it's kind of hard to take all the countries into account. So this is the vocabulary we're going to talk about today. Some of our concepts, a dial plan. So these are the concepts that you're going to see a lot within Link, and they are not always that clear. So a dial plan, we call this to codify dialing into E164, which is a very nice term for saying fixing the wrong kind of dialing that people do. So who's familiar with E164? Oh, we've got some. Next time I'll ask who's unfamiliar, because that can get more hands. So a very short explanation for E164. So whenever I'm from the Netherlands, and if I would dial someone within the Netherlands, let's say I would dial my colleague, who's also from the Netherlands, I would dial 020-500. 1489. Unfortunately, if I'm in Germany or I'm in the US, dialing that number would get me a completely different person. So what do we do with E164? We'll get a globally unique number. And E164 actually means that you're going to use your country code, which is 31 for the Netherlands, a region code, which is 020 for Amsterdam, and then your subscription number, subscriber number, subscriber access number even. So that's E164, basically. Country code, region code, and your extension. And we use those dial plans. Excuse me. We're going to dive into that a little bit deeper later on. We're going to assign them to people with the same dialing habits. Because the way I dial a number, someone from the same region would dial his numbers in the same way. But someone from Germany or from the US would use a different way to dial numbers. And that's what we use our dial plans for, to fix that dialing into and transform that into E164. Our voice policies are basically our authorization. It's the same thing they do in Active Directory. We use a voice policy to control the feature set a user has and control the amount of numbers or the type of numbers that user can call. The PSTN usages are used to link routes. And I've got a really nice graph about that later on. And our voice routes are basically saying if you're trying to dial a Dutch number, use the Dutch gateway, the Dutch breakout point. So those are the four main concepts that we're going to talk about today. So moving from there, we're going into link voice routing. So this is actually the slide and actually the picture that we're showing at introduction courses, that we're showing at deep dives, that we're showing at link masters. Because this is a very important picture. This is, and we'll go into all these points deeper later on, this is the way link works concerning voice routing, authorization, incoming, outgoing calls. This is a graphical representation of link and voice. So, what happens? I can use the mouse so we can actually point it. Oh, you don't see the mouse, right? Oh, you see. There we go. So we'll start with the user initiates call. Because that's the thing people do, right? So you pick up the horn or whatever, you start typing a number and you start a call. So whenever we've done that, we'll check, is it a SIP URI? So did I click a person or did I actually type a number? If I click the user, it's a SIP URI, I'm gonna apply the call party preference. So let's say Thomas calls me and we're using Simring, then we're starting Simring. Everything that I set up to make sure that my phone call would actually reach me. So that's the first thing. We're actually calling a SIP URI. But let's say we're gonna this inbound routing component has a very specific logic in it, and I'll show you some more about that later, that actually checks if we have enough bandwidth to reach that user, or if we maybe there's a network outage. So if we cannot reach that person over IP, we'll try a PSTN reroute. So we'll actually use a local gateway to traverse the PSTN network or maybe the internet and find that user anyway. So that's all part of inbound routing. So trying to reach someone and he's trying to help us reach that person. So moving from there, whenever we initiate the call, so let's say I've just typed in the number, we'll check, is this an emergency call? Did I dial 112 or 911? No, I did not, sure. Let's go into this. We'll check if it's a global number. And with a global number, we mean an E164 number. And who can tell me how we check if it's a global number? Plus. It's just plus. If your number starts with plus, we consider you to be intelligent enough to have typed in the correct number, and we'll route that number straight out to the gateway that we can find. That's our check for global. Is this a valid E164 number? And it has some implications, and we'll look at it later. It's not a global number, so I typed in a Dutch number. We'll normalize it. We'll make it a global number, and we'll use our normalization rules for that. Excuse me. And from there, we'll check if this is a we'll check if there's a if there's a what's it called a if it matches our call park orbit range. So that's first. Well, first we'll normalize, then we'll check our call park orbit range. It's a functionality within Link. You can park calls. If it matches the if it doesn't match our range, but it is a call park orbit number. That's a difficult sentence. I see. There was a nice plop for the plus. If it's a call park orbit range, but it doesn't match it. I'm pretty sure I can't explain it properly. Well, I'll come back to that later. That is gonna make sense. I promise. We've gone through the global. We've gone through the initiating call. We've checked if it's an emergency services number. We've gone through the check if it has a plus. We've gone through the normalization rules. So now it's a global number. We've transformed this global number into a global number. So now we'll move into our reverse number lookup, and we'll actually check if that number is attached to a person. One of the questions we always get is, well, I'm not clicking the dial user. I'm typing in his full number. Will it still be a VoIP call? Yes. We did the reverse number lookup. We checked both the line URI, so the tel URI, and the private line URI to make sure that if that user exists within the enterprise, it's a VoIP call. So if it matches, it's going to be sent to the inbound routing component, and it's now a VoIP call. If it doesn't match, we'll check if it's if this number is configured for a vacant number range, which means we're going to play back a message, or if it's part of the call park orbit range, which means we're trying to retrieve a parked call. If we don't hit it, we're going to check our voice policies. We're going to check, are we actually allowed to route this call outside the enterprise? Is there a route for this specific number? If there's no route, too bad. 403, no route found, and you'll see a nice message in your link line, too bad, I couldn't route the call. If we can find a route, we'll send it over to the mediation server, which we're going to send it to a gateway intern, and the gateway will convert that E164 number to an understandable number for the local PSTN connection. So in a nutshell, this is how Link voice routing works. So now we're gonna zoom in on certain aspects. So we're gonna start with the numbering and dialing. So the RFC 3966 actually defines E164 for us. So it tells us how does a tel URI need to look. It tells us if numbers have to start with a plus, and if it doesn't start with a plus, it needs to be given a context. So for instance, when we get an incoming call from a gateway that doesn't start with a plus, because the gateway didn't normalize the number, we can make the gateway add a specific phone context of a dial plan so that Link knows that it still needs to normalize this number. That's the bottom one-to-one phone context is HQ example. So these are the formats we'll use in Link. And in all fairness, the second one that has the EXT equals is the one that we highly recommend you use. And why do we like this? So whenever you're implementing Link voice, you'd like people to have a phone number, right? It's nice to have people to be able to call people, especially from the outside. So what you'll see, especially in pilot deployments, you get a new number range that has a 100 to 500 phone numbers, and you'll assign those to users. And it's very, very, I'll show you, it's very easy or very tempting to actually just insert a number without the EXT. So let's take a look at the user. So this is the Link server control panel. So let's find my user. I named it Cornel because that makes it easier to find. So let's enable this user for enterprise voice, and let's give it a tell URI. So let's give it my office phone number. And I've now assigned it a number. So it's a valid URL. You've seen it in the slide. It starts with a plus, tell plus, commit the change, and this user now has a phone URI. So if I were to be connected to the PSTN, I could now call this user. It's as simple as that. That's why Link is a brilliant PBX. So if I now go, so the issue with not assigning an EXT is that, first of all, let's say I have 1,000 users and I have 200 people that I want to be able I have 1,000 users and I have 200 phone numbers I can give out to my users. I'm 800 numbers short. By using the EXT, and I'll show you an example in the slide, by using an EXT, I can actually reuse a DID and assign multiple extensions to the same DID. And once again, I'll show you that in an example. But the main advantage for the user is when this user now goes to Darling Conferencing and he joins a conference, he gets asked for a phone number. You can't log in with on the same server with two accounts at the same time. Whenever you you log into the conference, it asks you for your telephone number. So if you're Dutch, that's going to be 11 digits, while I have like a 3-digit extension, which makes my life way easier. Also, when a user goes to his Darling Conferencing page, it will tell him or her whatever his extension is and whatever that person can use to log in. So when I now go to my Darling Conferencing page, it will show me that there's no extension configured for me. So it's nice. Live demos where you have to wait. There we go. Oh, been. There we go. So it will tell me there's no extension configured. That is not. So every time I log into a conference, I now have to type in the full 11 digits to identify myself, plus my PIN code, and it's going to be a real bother. But if I were to go to the extension panel and I just, and there's no change in functionality, there's no change in the actual usage of the product for the end user. If we just give it an extension, like this, I just add semicolon, ext equals, 84. And I would now go to my dial-in page. It will show me that I have a that I actually have a valid extension. See, it will now tell me the warning's gone. It's going to tell me whenever you're joining a conference, use 84 to identify yourself, and it doesn't affect incoming calls. So that's the trick with the extensions. So SQT specified extensions for all users because it optimizes the PIN auth. We also use this extension whenever you have the desk phones. We've got some in the Link booth. You can log in using a USB cable, but you can also use your extension, which is once again either your 11 digits for the Netherlands direct dial-in number, or it's just a 2-digit or 3-digit extension. It's going to make your life a lot easier. The reverse number lookup doesn't really care about extensions, so you don't have to change all kinds of routing. The only thing you need to make sure is that whenever you route to the gateway, your gateway understands that you're now going to add an EXT. So, as I said, you've got 1,000 users, only 200 numbers to distribute. What you can do is give everyone needs to have a unique tell URI. And the unique tell URI can all share the same DID, so the same number, as long as they have unique extensions. So you'll add the EXT equals 1 to like your receptionist or to your, in this example, exchange auto attendant. you'll set up a trunk rule, rule in your gateway that adds the ext equals 1 to your incoming number. And now everyone that calls you on that specific number will reach the receptionist or the exchange auto attendant. You can tell the auto attendant the name of the person you're calling. And it will then reroute you to the correct person. So it's a very easy way to make the best use of the numbers you've got. Once again, this is all described in the RFC, and we fully support that RFC. So that was assigning numbers to users. As I said, we're going to move rather quickly, moving into the fragments. So rather than just telling you, I'll show you again. So if you look at the phone number, so if I'm in the Netherlands, I'm going to dial someone, so I'm going to dial 020-500-1489. It's not going to work. This is a Dutch local number. We need to fix this, and rather than try to educate all your people, telling them, well, you should use plus country code, region code, and make sure you do that, we found it way easier to just fix this in the system. So what we can do is go into the control panel, and I'll set up a dial plan. So I'll go to voice routing, dial plan, I'll create a new dial plan. Let's make this so I can do this per site, per pool, per user. Let's make a nice user. So let's make this Dutch people. That's fine. And I'm going to tell them whenever someone's dialing 10-digit national, whenever it's dialing a number starting with a 0, that's exactly 10 digits long, let's take off the first digit and add plus 3-1. Let's commit this. So what's going to happen now? Whenever I type in a 10-digit number, which is, so all numbers in the Netherlands would be 10 digits as long as it's not a service number, I'll fix that for the user. So let's wait for the replication. Replication, nicest thing link. So whenever that's replicated, it gets pushed down to the client in the next time the client logs in. So let's take my client, I'll log out. There you go, sign out. Let's go with replication. Once again, I love live demos. It just never goes wrong. There we go. Green is always good. So you see me type in the 10-digit number, and whenever I type in the 10-digit number this time, so has anyone been to Jamie's session, Jamie Stark's session, where he made a beautiful comment on whenever you log in, it's always a mystery if it works or not? Well, that's how I feel right now. So whenever I type in the same number now, sure, beautiful. That's very smart. So I made a dial plan and I never assigned a dial plan. So that's just the easy things in life. So we've made a dial plan and let's assign the dial plan to that user. That's it. That's all we need to do. So, and the beauty of the dial plans is, since it's assigned to this user, wherever I am, so let's say I'm in the US, or I'm in Germany, or I'm in Austria, wherever I am, I can use my Dutch dialing habits to dial wherever I need to go. Because I know if I need to dial someone in the US, I'll start with 001. That's how I dial the US. And if I'm in the US, I know I need to use a 9 for an external, then I need to use some other digit that Microsoft uses, and I don't even remember because it's on the phone, to get an international call, and I don't have to do that. I just use my Dutch dialing patterns. So this time, if I now type in the number correctly, it will actually normalize it for me to the E164 format, which we can actually use within Link. So that's the dial plan per habit group. And it will fix my dial plan. that fix my manual input with the dial pad, but also the impact, the input from Outlook contacts that you might have configured with 10 numbers with local dialing rules. Exchange also uses this dial plan to dial his numbers. So this is a pretty important piece of link. We need to make sure that those numbers are normalized so we can actually use them with a link, and we do that using the dial plans to fix these fragments. So the places where we can apply this dial plan, so we'll use that inbound to the mediation server, inbound from the gateway, and there are some caveats. One of the caveats is if you don't have the correct numbers in AD, so you don't have E164 in AD for whatever reason, and you can't change it to E164, you're going to be needing, you will need to change it using the address book normalization rules, and we'll show you an example of that in the next few slides. And if you've got remote call control deployed, that will not honor any dialing plans. So that's also a thing that might be important to know whenever you're going to do remote call control. So configuring the dial plans, I like to use the wizard. It's easy, it shows you what's going to happen. It's hard to make errors there. But we fully support the use of regular expressions. So what the wizard actually does, and you can see that in the little dialogue. So whenever I click my whenever I used the wizard, it actually told me this is the pattern you've just built, and this is your translation rule. So I could go and edit that, and I can build any kind of translation rule. If I were to match very, and I believe we have got some examples here. If I were to match for instance, in North America, instead of the wizard doesn't allow me to check that the first number is a 2 up to a 9, but it shouldn't be a 1. The wizard doesn't allow me to do that. So we can use the regular expressions, and you can build your own patterns to match and your own results. So the first regular expression that you'll see here, make sure the first number is a 2 to 9. We'd like we'd like another digit, then we'd like another 2 to 9, then another 6 digits, and translate that into plus 1, and then whatever was between the brackets. Second one, like a UK number, looks like the Dutch numbers, starts with a 0, then 10 digits, translate that into plus 4, 4, then whatever is between the brackets. So the second one we could do with the wizard. First one we couldn't do, and especially the extension ranges, like 1500 up to 3500, you're going to need regular expressions. If you're going to use the wizard, you're going to use at least, well, 5, 6. From the top of my head, 18 different rules for that. Because you're going to be matching 31, 34, 32, 33, 34, 35, which you can't match the 3,000 range, because the 36 isn't in the range. so just using one line keeps it a lot more manageable. That's one temptation that's always there, is to make the most impressive regular expression. And we like to do that, and I'll show you one of those regular expressions later on, but that's a... That's going to be impossible to manage because it makes perfect sense whenever you're configuring it. Yes? Yes. We'll go there. I'll show you. So there's one slide in the middle, and then we'll go there. So who has deployed OCS or OCS R2 with voice? Good, Thomas. I hoped you did. So... There was a challenge whenever you were using the Tangier devices, the phones, that they would, as soon as we matched a rule, a dialing, we called them then location profiles. As soon as we matched a rule, we'd use that rule. which wasn't all that convenient if you had like a 3-digit extension configured and you needed to do like with the checkboxes. And we fixed that in Link. So as long as there's less than 1.5 seconds between pressing buttons, you're fine. We will match the first digit, the first rule we hit, if there's more than 1.5 seconds between hitting keys. So that's fixed. No more strange checkboxes. No more trying to elude that. Once again, we fixed it. And you have to type the number within 10 seconds. But we should be able to do that. External access prefixes. So who works with a company that requires you to do a prefix, like a 0 or a 9 before dialing out? Yeah, so what we'd like you to do is, whenever you implement Link, tell the users, don't do it anymore. We realize that that's not going to work. So we've had there's a nice little feature, which I can show you. There's a feature within the product, so within the dialing plans, that actually show you that my external access prefix is, let's say, a 9. And this 10-digit national is not an internal number. So let's commit this first, and I'll show you. So what I can do is tell Link people are going to be dialing a 9 if they want to reach a number outside. Then I can also say, well, if they're going to dial a, let's say I'm using a 3-digit internal extension which starts with a 4. And I can mark this very specifically mark this as an internal extension. So I now have two normalization rules. One that's marked as an internal extension, one that's marked as a non-internal extension. So as soon as I hit that 9 on my dialing pad, it will immediately exclude any internal extension, and it will only go through the numbers that we've not marked internal extension. So once this has been committed and replicated, I can show you. So the only thing we need to do is add 9 to the internal extension. You're fine. You don't need to change any dialing plans, no more extra normalization rules. It just works. So that was a requested feature that we were happy to bring in. Not completely happy, because we'd rather have you tell your users, well, you should use E164 for all your numbers. We most certainly realize that that's not going to work in a day-to-day environment. So let's do a sign out. So I can still use the dialing without the extension. So I can still use my 10-digit dialing. Is it going to work today? So, Jamie, I know you're there. You've really messed me up with the comment that says, is it going to work or not every time you sign in? It's very distracted. So this still works. I'm dialing without the extension. But if I were to dial the same number and I'm using the way I've been taught to use the PBX system, so start with the 9, it will still normalize to a decent number. So very easy thing to do. And you don't have to teach your users new tricks. There's the external access prefix. So the Adamsburg normalization, I promised I would say something more about that. So we used to have it in OCS and OCS R2 as well. There were all kinds of, you need to incorporate all the spaces and everything. So whenever a number is global, and we've learned when a number is global, if a number is global, we'll include it in the address book. So goes through your AD, checks for mobile numbers, phone numbers, and it will add it to the address book if it's global. If for any reason, because you're still running with a legacy system and you can't put E164 in there, for whatever reason, you're unable to put E164 numbers in your address book, in your AD, you can use the phone normalization rules. It's a TXT file. And you can use the same regular expressions to fix those numbers into E164 So your AD stays the same, but Link now has all the numbers from all the users in dialable E164 format. That's the address book website, the address book normalization. So we've done dial plans, we've done normalization, making good time. We'll move. Yes. It will ignore that, yeah. So brackets are ignored. So spaces, punctuation, those are ignored. So if you're, so what we like to do in the Netherlands, which is bothering me very much, is we like to do +3, 1, bracket, 0, bracket, 2, 0, something, something, which is not correct. That's not what E164 tells us, or the RFC tells us that you're allowed to do. But if you copy-paste that number into Link, it will happily dial all the digits because it will ignore the brackets. So what you can do is make an address book normalization rule and fix that. Whenever I build dial plan normalization rules for the Netherlands, that's a specific rule I put in there. +3, 1, 0, take out the 0. Yes? Yes. Yes, top down. Yeah. Yes, so we'll strip that off in the normalization. Yes. So Thomas? Thomas,
I don't think you can do that.
No.
I don't think it will work as you expect. It will just dial the full number.
Well. No. No, it's a. But you wouldn't have the problem if you used link conferencing. So it's maybe a bit of a harsh solution, but it will. No, so commas, no. If you meant specifically for pausing, no. That's we'll strip that off because we'll think that's a typo. Yeah, we'll get there. We'll get there. I'd love to answer all of your questions, but I'll try to finish in 27 minutes, and then we'll have all the time in the world to answer any question you have. So the routing and authorization. So this can be rather quick. Why do you want to do routing? Because if we have gateways in multiple countries, we'd like to use a local gateway to keep calls down. Or if you're in India, land you in jail. Whenever you try to do least cost routing, make sure you check with your lawyers if it's actually allowed in the country that you're in. I want to be very specific, or else I'm going to get angry emails that I put you in jail. Cost is our driving factor for routing, least cost routing. So, and this has been a subject of a lot of debates. How does our routing work within Link? And it's actually very simple. You've got a voice policies that you can assign to a user or a group of users or a site. Those policies have usages in them. And the order of the usage is important. And you can order the usages per policy. So just because I put usage 1 on top in policy 1 doesn't mean it's that usage 1 is on top in policy 2. And those usages link to routes. And those routes actually contain the numbers and the gateways that should be connected to each other. And the order of the routes is important, as in, we use the order of the routes. So if you have two routes that route to the same number, and one route is on top of the other, we'll use the other route, but you cannot sort them within the usage. There's a global sorting. So as soon as you try to do fallback routing, so fillover routing, and you try to use routes for that, that's going to be very interesting. you're going to get very, well, interesting results. And I'll show you that on my machine. So a voice policy can have multiple usages. Multiple usages can be members of multiple policies, and a usage can have multiple routes. When you're starting with Link Voice, keep it simple. Take a policy, create multiple usages, and create a nice one-on-one relationship with your usages and routes until you feel very familiar with your routes, so that you can actually order which route to take first by ordering the usages. And I'll show you that. So whenever, and if you add a new policy, you can use all your existing usages. So let's show you that real quick. So let's say I have my voice routing. Let's create a two policies. So this is policy one. And we have policy two. So as you can see, a policy enables people for stuff like delegation, call transfer, call park. All these options are built within your policy. I can associate PSTN usages. So let's make this usage one. We'll make this NL1. And we'll build another one, NL2. And let's go to the other policy. And we'll have a nice NL3. And we can reuse, So we'll have to, it doesn't matter. So we'll have the three usages. Why? Fine. So we have NL2 and 3 in policy 2. And policy 1, we can use an existing usage, 1 and 2. So as you can see, I can order so I can say I want you to check usage 2 for an applicable route before you check usage 1. I can change the order. That's fine. But as soon as I start adding routes, so let's say this is a route NL, and it's going to match +31. So every time a user dials +31, I want to make sure that this route is used. And let's make a same route, because this is a failover, NL2. Also match +31. So now I have three usages. I have two routes. I can change the order of the routes. So I can make sure that this route is my least expensive gateway. This is my least. If I'm dialing over this gateway, they only charge me like a cent per minute. But the other gateway, I want the secondary gateway in there for if the primary fails. So, but that charges me 10 cents a minute. So I'd be very tempted to use this same usage and add both routes into that same usage. Because, one usage is easy to assign. It's Dutch numbers. Let's use one usage. But then we'll use the order of the routes as they are on this page. So on the routes page, which is a global sorting. So if I would add a third route, and I would like the people from the north of the Netherlands use route 1 and the south route 2, but I want to have the other route as a fallback, I could basically, so as soon as I want to sort these within the usage, and I wanted for usage 1 NL2 on top, I put NL2 on top, but I've also changed it in my other usage. So now my other people would also start dialing over that single route. Did it make any sense? Yeah, so let's make another route, and then I can show you. So I now have three routes. They all route to +31, but they all have a different gateway. So in voice policy one, let me take my usage. In usage one, I want to make sure that that I use gateway 1, and if gateway 1 fails, that I use gateway 2 as a backup gateway. So I go into my policies, and let's do it easy. Let's get my PSTN usage 1. And I'll add both of my route NL and my route 2 in here. So as you can see the order. I'll try route NL first, then I'll try route 2. So now I'll go into my secondary policy. And I want to keep it simple, so I'm using one usage. So I'll do the same trick. So I have NL2, and I have route NL. And now it looks like I would use route 2 first, because it's on top, right? Route 2 is higher than route NL. So this looks like I've configured it perfectly. You can see I've added usage 1 to route 1. I've added usage 1 to policy 1, usage 2 to policy 2. But when I added another usage, I could change the preference of the usage, which one to use first and which one to use secondary. If I now select the policy, you can see that I would try NL2 first, then route NL in all cases, even though it showed me something very different when I was configuring it. Now it makes more sense, right? There we go. I can do it. So, lesson to learn here. You can order the usages. You should not be ordering the routes. Please make a one-on-one relationship. Use it, one usage, one route. Order the usages, and you're fine. It's going to work exactly as you expected. Or else you're going to get very angry emails from the finance people asking you why you're routing all the Dutch calls over a Belgium gateway. And you wouldn't be the first one. So, moving from there. So why do we like global numbers? So you can see I was matching a number, +31, and I was telling them, well, if someone dialed +31, it's in this voice policy, send it out to a gateway. Why am I using global numbers? Why am I not just, because there was a question before about, well, my PSTN provider requires me to do a 0, or my PBX requires me to do a 0 before I dial out. Why don't I just build this, my internal dialing plan in Link? It's way easier. And it's easier as long as your Link cannot dial outside and is just within your company. But as soon as you start adding other countries, then you're going to be having interesting things like, I'm putting my 9, the prefix that you saw before, and I'll just build a dial plan to fix that. But now whenever I try to dial India, so I'm calling the US +91, but I should be routed to India, +91 is India. So I'm 6046, internal extension, I cannot dial that. Well, let's add a plus, it's a global number, Link can route it, it'll go to the PBX, everything's fine. That's too bad, 6.0 is Malaysia. So your gateway shouldn't route it to the PBX, should route it to Malaysia. So by going away from the E164, you're now really making countries like India unavailable for anyone within your company. Or Malaysia, or I didn't do any country codes. So 212, a US region code, I just add a plus in front. Well, I'm now... My gateway is now trying to dial Morocco for me. So this sounds really simple, and this sounds like, well, I would never do that. But I get daily emails. Our costs are really high. We keep dialing India. I know why. So that's important. So how would you design a dial plan? You start with your routes. Then you build your policies, and you can use the usages as glue to fix those routes to those policies. So let's look at an example. I've got Munich, and for the people that are from Germany and are greatly offended right now because of my geographical knowledge of Munich, I'm very aware that that's not Munich. It's a US map. I'm sorry, I can't help it. But in fairness, they did get Seattle right, so it's points for them. So we'll define the different routes we'd like to have, like internal, local, national, national premium, international. I'm defining the classes of service I'm going to give my users. So I might give some users only internal dialing, some users only local dialing, some users internal and local. So I've defined my route. I now know which numbers do I want to route outside. So this will get me really easy dialing rules. So these are all regular expressions. I'm going to match for internal, going to match my internal number range, my Munich local range, my Europe range, international, just a plus. Very easy. Because so within our team, I used to get like a lot of flack for, well, you're from Europe, you want to do everything your own way, and you've got so many countries, it's really difficult telephony. And if we do the same thing for Seattle, you'll see what's difficult and which country really makes it hard. So this is just, and this is all for billing purposes, right? So we want to make sure that if we dial local numbers, we get local rates. So all these nice little extensions are all considered local to Seattle. Which, and then I'll come back to a question about, is there something that can help me fix this and can help me get like a list of these extensions? Because this is horrible to do. Because I'd love to say this is just Seattle, and Seattle is a strange city. No. This is not just Seattle. And unfortunately, we do some strangeness within Europe as well. So there is a guy called Ken, and he has a blog. And he called it very nicely Ken's Unified Communication Blog, which makes sense if your name is Ken. And he's made a PowerShell script generator. So before you use it, it's if it breaks, it's not my fault. Just like the going to jail, it's not my fault. But it is fairly accurate. I haven't found an issue yet. He keeps updating it. So you can just say, well, I want a dial plan for Germany or a dial plan for whatever country you need. And it will actually generate those a PowerShell script that you can run on the link server, and your dial plans are all done. For all the people taking notes and making pictures, usually take pictures of me, so now taking pictures of the screen is nice. But you'll be able to download the presentation, and you can just copy paste. It's way easier. So that's the link optimizer, and the rules you see here, they were actually created by the link optimizer, because I use it too, and it works. But please check before you implement. So, planning the routes. So the routes are, as you can see, same as the dialing plan. We keep using regular expressions. It's the magic word. Make sure you also specify internal numbers. So if I have an internal number range for Microsoft NL, it's +31, 20, 500, and then four numbers. I need to specify that as a route, even though it's with reverse number lookup, we make it a VoIP call. If I would be in the US and I couldn't reach a colleague because of bandwidth restrictions, I would do a PSTN reroute. It would look at my route. It would check, is this user actually allowed to call internal numbers? And if I don't have that internal numbers right assigned to me, I wouldn't be able to use PSTN reroute. So that's an important point. That's one of the questions we get a lot with call it mission control. Well, you should be able to do PSTN reroute. It doesn't work. They're not allowed to dial it. If you have multiple gateways in the same location, you can add them to the same route, and we'll use round robin to distribute the calls over them. It's not load balancing. It's round robining. It's called that way. That's a nice word, round robining. A new word for the day. If the routes of the gateways is in order, it's the same as before. Use PSTN usages, single routes, single gateways, and use usages to order them. Don't use routes. So we've gone through this, voice policies. We can specify voice policies to users. They grant you certain rights, certain routes. We can specify them on a user level. You saw me create a Dutch dial plan and a Dutch policy. I can assign them to a user, to a pool, to a link site, or I can just use the global so that everybody has the same policy. So if you have one country and everybody is allowed to use the same policy, you can just use a global. One point to note is that these are not... within AD, so who's familiar with Active Directory policies? Most of you are, right? Yeah, most of you are. So I'm going to assume everybody is, because that makes my life easier. It always inherits settings from the parent. So if I set something on a parent level, and on a child level, I now add an additional setting, I get both settings. Does it work like that with link? When it works like that in AD, I give you that. Within link, so if you, a lot of people create dialing plans on a global level because that's the same for everyone, and then create very specific, user-specific dialing rules, assign that to the user, and then they'll say, well, that's strange. It doesn't pick up the global ones. It's true. It will pick up whatever you've assigned it, and it doesn't look at the parent policies. So we be aware of that. Entitlements. It's the voice features. You can. Jamie did a nice presentation about all the different stuff it will do. It's also range true voice policies. voice, the PSTN usages, we've gone through that. We can use them to glue the routes to the policy. Just to be clear, if your first usage has a route that matches but the gateway is down, we will look at the next usage if that also has a matching route. So you can use multiple usages to create backup routing. That leaves us with best practices. And I'll come back to the question about zero and the special numbers the PBX requires. So even though E164 is a standard and E164 is a very nice way to dial numbers, well, try dialing a plus on your old analog phone. You've got a star, you've got a bracket, but there's no plus. So sometimes when we're talking to a gateway or talking to a PBX, we need to change the number we're sending out because we would be sending out a global number, E164 number. So what you could do using the trunk rules, you can basically tell them, well, this PBX, if it gets a plus, replace that plus with a 00. So, or get a steering code in there. Whenever you're, and once again, it's using regular expressions. So if you're dialing this number, I need to add this steering code. So a steering code is sort of a pre-selection code when going to a PBX. It will tell the PBX, give the PBX additional information on what to do with the number. And you can use the trunk translation rules for that. So it will use the number you're dialing. It will transform that number into the number you've specified it should be. So that's new for link. That's a much requested feature on OCS, because on OCS we just throw out the E164 number and you are required to do normalization on the gateway or the PBX, and not all PBXs like that. So that's the trunk rules. E901, a few people have been to Jamie's session. Jamie told something about it. So it's a special location policy that will actually intercept if you're dialing an emergency services number. And if you look at, if you remember the slide from the beginning, the first thing we'll do whenever we're routing a call is check, did that user dial an emergency number? If so, let's route it to the emergency services provider. Let's not go through the whole normalization and routing stuff. It's an emergency. Let's route it outside. It's location sensitive, so depending on the location you're at, you can send it to a different emergency services number. So if I were to dial 112 in the Dutch Microsoft building, I'd get the Dutch emergency services. If I were to dial Microsoft in the German building, if I were to dial 112 in the German building, I'd get the German emergency services number, even though I'm still in the same voice policy, same dial plans, everything's the same. But Link knows you're in Germany now, German emergency services. One of the features that we've been asked to, well, how do you do this? How do we block certain numbers? We simply don't route them. As you could see in our voice routes, we could say, let's say for the NL routes, we could basically say, well, if the number starts with +31, then use this route. What I could do is create an exception. And for instance, the Dutch entertainment numbers are +31909. Don't remember that, because you, once again, I'll get in trouble for telling you this when you're calling it from your hotel. That's the +31909 numbers, since they are now excluded, I won't route them. So the users will get a will get an error. Couldn't route this number. You can imagine that this gets really complicated because as soon as I create an international dialing policy, I now have to add every single paid phone number all over the world to that international number. Or else that person that's allowed to make an international call can now dial every... So he can dial the paid services number in his own country, but he can just call the British or the German number. So we've thought of something, and it's actually a nice solution. It's also a drastic solution. So what you could do is... So what it does do, if you use the routes, it provides you with great flexibility. Because sometimes if you deal with HP, they have a paid service number in the Netherlands, and if I exclude paid services numbers, I can now not dial HP to tell them my laptop's broken. So using the routes, you can have certain people be allowed to dial those numbers, certain people not. If you have a range that just shouldn't be dialed by anyone, you can assign an unassigned number range. And once again, if you go to the picture at the beginning, you could see that's one of the things we check before we go outside. Is this number an unassigned number? So you can add a nice text-to-speech or a nice WMA file and tell the user the number you're trying to dial is blocked by your company. Use the unassigned number range for that. And you can even then reconnect the call to that person's boss, and you can do all funny stuff with that. It is very drastic, because no one in your company can now dial that number anymore, which for certain entertainment numbers wouldn't be a bad thing. But this is not well known that you can use unassigned numbers for that. So we've learned something new. One of the best practices, removing the plus. A lot of PBXs don't like plus. They want either 00 or they just want the country code. So if you use a trunk rule to remove that plus, it will only remove the plus from the number that you're dialing. It will not remove the plus from your tell URI. If you use the set CS trunk configuration and you set the remove plus from URI to true, it will not only remove the plus from the number you're dialing, but also the number that you're dialing from. And the second one, and that's why we're giving out the slides, so you can copy paste these. Sending semicolon ext equals to a gateway that might end badly. So there's a trunk rule that you could use to fix this semicolon ext. Because if we're doing PSTN reroute, we'll look at the tell URI, and we won't look at Active Directory. So you would need to add that to your trunk rule. Always use a DID. Always use a DID with an extension. Adding outline access codes like a 9. We've seen why that's wrong. Why that's can be confusing, and why you can have a lot of calls to India. Private extensions are private extensions. They warrant an ext equals. don't use them as global numbers, and E164 tells us use a country code in your Telluride. I've dealt with a lot of companies that have expanded to a different country and were then very surprised by the fact that the whole OCS environment or Link environment now had an issue dialing a different country because they built everything on local numbers. How many dial plans are we allowed to do? We support 700 dial plans per deployment, and you can have 100 plus normalization rules per dial plan. So you can, there's quite a lot of flexibility. It allows you to do a worldwide deployment. And if you use a Link optimizer, you'll also be able to do as less as possible normalization rules. Because adding more normalization rules, they're downloaded to the client, and the client processes them, it will add to the dialing time, the normalization time on the client. I think that's it. Oh, we've got 10 minutes to spare, right on time. So we've talked about Link voice routing. We've talked about the dial plan, why we would need it. We've talked about some best practices. There are more sessions about this, especially tomorrow morning. The amazing Thomas Binder will have some on Friday, Link in the Enterprise Network. There are two exams that you can take, which allows you to qualify to be a Microsoft Certified Master. So go take the exams, go take the master. It's fun. Me and Thomas and Kwang and Jamie and all the Link guys, they will be at the Link booth in the Tech Expo. So if you have additional questions, feel free to drop by. You'll have to do you don't have to. I'd like you to do the evaluations, because then I can tell Lauren that I've made you do the evaluations and she won't get mad at me. And just feel free to give your comments and whatever you like, how you like the session, because we can only improve sessions if you give your honest opinion. And that's it for me. And then we'll have 8 minutes and 30 seconds to either leave early for the party or to ask me any question you can think of. So we'll go ahead. Thank you. Yeah, that's fine.
So when I build dial plans, and must I correct the number in the gateway or in?
So the question. So you're dialing. So we have an access code, an area code, and then we have the subscriber number.
Without extension.
So, but how would you be able to reach anyone if you don't have an extension number? It's the gateway. There we go. Fixed. Go ahead. I like standing on the stage.
So E164 numbering in the UK is special, where you have rules almost match most of the time, except for the edge cases where they don't. So 0800 numbers, for example, or 0800 and 70.
Yeah, that's unfortunately, that's the case in every number, in any country. Yeah. Link optimizer. Yeah, Link optimizer. So it will have most of them. I'd always talk to both local legal and local, just call someone from that region and ask them, just ask your users, how do you dial your numbers? So what I used to do in the past is just send them a list and ask them, well, could you please describe to me how you dial your numbers in a database and who are you going to reach? So they're going to say, well, I'm going to reach a paid service number, and I'm dialing it like this. And so, and you'll have to build lists like that, and you'll probably get it wrong. And people will complain. They're saying, well, I'm trying to dial this, and I'm not getting what I'm expecting. And you'll fix your dial plan, and it's a learning exercise.
Yeah. Yeah. That's the way we're doing it.
Yes. Yes. But Link Optimizer has most of them. Cool.
When you will fix the hierarchy problem?
Sorry, when will I fix it? Yeah. There's nothing to fix.
When you are fixing these.
Yeah, no, so there's so the hierarchy on like the pool level and the say that the child policies would get the settings from the parents, right? Yeah, that's
for that plan as well, because we put the internal journal for that plan.
Yes. You can do that.
Yeah, but it's not. I have to add this delta, this internal delta per country always.
Yeah. So so it depends on your deployment. So if you have local pools or sites defined, then you could use sites. But in general, yeah, if you have a single pool and you have a lot of smaller deployments of links, smaller subsidiaries, then yeah, you'd be deploying, you'd be assigning a per user dial plan. Yeah, and that. So, but I wouldn't know how inheriting dial plans from a parent from a global would fix that.
If we have one working for one dial plan for Finland, and then under Finland we have.
Yeah, like that. Yeah, for the different regions. Yeah, I get. So, so that would be a very valid request. I don't know when we would fix that, if we would fix that, and if we would think that would be something to fix. I don't know. It's you'll have to build separate dial plans. I wouldn't see that fixed in the foreseeable future. Yeah. That's what it's going to be. Copy them. Yeah. So if you build a new dial plan, you can actually select your existing rules and paste them in, and unfortunately, that is the way it is right now. I wish I had a better answer. I don't. Sorry.
When I receive the call, the link is link normalization as for the code number.
Yes.
Is it possible somehow, to turn it off this one, because it is like PBX normally works, when I receive call within a company, I usually see only the extension number, so company asks me,
okay, so a number comes in, but just from the from within the company or from where?
Say within a company. I have called this with the OPP.
Yeah.
So for the internal calls, just like to show in the link client, only the extension.
Yes. So we could do that. I would highly recommend against that, because to be able to dial that number back, you would then have to build a very ugly dial plan rule. A very ugly route to route it back to the PBX, because you wouldn't want to be able to normalize that number to E164. But I actually wouldn't even go into that far. I would ask the customer, well, wouldn't we just put in the numbers in Active Directory? Even if it's just extensions in Active Directory and we use the address book normalization to build that back into E164, then instead of having an extension, you'd actually have a name. So you'd know who was calling you. Which I'd rather steer the discussion into that direction. So, because, well, with Link, we don't care about numbers. Numbers is just, well, it's impersonal.
It's
just
a habit, so
yeah, I know, it's a habit. And while we could do it, I wouldn't like doing that. It's going to be a because as soon as you're gone from the PBX and you're now in a link-only deployment, when are you going to take away those extensions? Because you'll still have those extensions, and you're still going to make sure that whenever you call someone back, that doesn't normalize to E164, and it's going to mess up your telluris. I would not be happy. So I'd steer it towards normalization. So.
Say if you had like a 70 dial plan with the Cisco PBX, so it's asking to work in an E164. Clearly, you advise to use E164 and Link. How would you
Very good.
How would you manipulate? So, basically, using like the
So what? So you've got seven digits.
Seven digits on a Cisco phone.
Yeah,
and extension mobility using user device profiles.
Yeah.
A remote destination profile to effectively forward the call.
Yeah.
So you could call a Cisco phone and a link client.
Yeah. So I. So that's. What's the correct term for not very nice? So the problem I see with, so that discussion is it's a very lively discussion. The problem with that is Link doesn't understand that it's forked. So if you pick up on the Cisco phone, you get a missed call. So that's problem one that I see. So
Cisco retains the call stack, so Cisco can actually take the call back.
Yeah, but Link doesn't understand that. So it's, so it's ugly, but sure. So what you could do is get a dial plan, attach that dial plan to the PBX, so you can actually create a pool dial plan and assign that to a gateway, and then we could normalize the incoming number. And it would also do the call it would only do the called number, also the calling, both. Yeah, so calling and called.
I've set it with OCSR too, using a dial logic gateway and TDM.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly. So I'd rather use a gateway in between to fix
so
numbers and have two dial plans.
Yeah, I mean currently I've got Link integrated using the direct SIP from the call manager, and then we manipulate some of the digits at the trunk.
But I'd say you're having the wrong conversation. I'd say the conversation should be, when are we moving away from Cisco so we don't have this seven-digit shit.
Cisco contact center.
But we have pretty nice contact centers for Link too. No, so that's the I don't have a better answer, but it's I'd go with
I mean, I was